Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome again to the second chat for this course for this evening. It is 7:15 Jamaican time, 8:15 Atlantic Standard Time. Thank you again for coming, for those persons who are watching online YouTube, and for those who are online during the Google Hangout, welcome again. For some classroom and some class announcements, just wanted to let people know that I have I've completed marking the first reflective exercise post. I have started to send people their grades by email, and I will be doing so again. Some people may have gotten. Generally, what I have found is that persons have the overall posts have had some quality, but some people were had fallen down in not reading the material that was given for it to be react to, and also they were not integrating the videos. Also, what I noticed is that some of the first post was late, so some people lost marks for that. So please ensure that for the post that's due tomorrow, it's due not tomorrow, it is due tonight at 11:55 Jamaican time and whatever time Guyana time and Atlantic Standard Time for the post. So when I get in and looking on Wednesday, I should see clearly that it's before midnight. Just to remind people that the second post, I've also noticed people were making responses, but the responses were very short. You are to really provide quality posts for your second post in terms of what you feel the person may have said. People would have lost marks because some of the posts were very, very brief and had nothing to do with the topic totally. Some people were going and bearing off. So the first exercise would have been worth 10 points. The balance of the postings for the three other chats for the rest of the course is worth 25 points. I would not be sending you feedback after this. The only time I'll send you feedback is on the first post. Secondly, just to remind persons that people were asking again about the papers, that the papers are the maximum time to complete the papers are the 31st of December for both the movie, the individual paper, and also for the final exam. However, people are free to send in or turn in the assignments way before that. I have no problems with that. That's just the maximum deadline for that. Also, I have received one person's course acknowledgement, and I will need the rest to be sent. Some people, you can copy the quote, you can sign it, copy it, and paste it in the body of the email you send me. That way I know that it has been sent, and I will cut and paste and put it in a special file for assignments. If you have any questions after you have received your grades for the first post, then feel free to either email me or call. Are there any questions before I go into the second lecture?
Here's a question, Dr. Mark.
Yes, where is the question? I'm not seeing it.
Michelle was saying that she last week, it was Tuesday, that the first post was due.
Mm-hmm. No, I saw Wednesday morning early in the morning. According to me, so I saw Wednesday. So it's assuming. So what I'll do, for people who have written about that, I'll go back and look. But I really saw Wednesday morning, and it was because if people post beyond 12 o'clock, if people post up 12 o'clock, I wouldn't be that hard. But if you post every hour afterwards, you lose a point because it means that you're past the way past the deadline. So So the deadline is 5 minutes before. Midnight, you're cutting it close, but I can accept that. But it should be before midnight.
Okay.
Question, Dr. Mark.
Yes, Ms. Thompson.
I don't recall whether you indicated so far, but when will the movies be provided for the individual project?
The movies were sent.
The movies were sent
and posted
online. Today I added the list. I posted the list today online.
Thank you for raising that issue. They have been posted, and they are now available online for you. To make a selection, it will be very, very helpful to start now. I want students to send me the title of the movie, and more than likely you'll have to go to YouTube. I suggest that you don't send just sections for me to watch. A whole movie will be helpful. That way I don't have to keep going and it stops and I have to keep finding where the other parts are. So a whole full-blown movie will be helpful. And it should, as I said before, you should really look for movies that are reflecting the DSM-5.
Dr. Mark, if I'm, are you saying that we should send you the title of the movie that we will do for the individual assignment?
I will need to know the title of the movie.
Okay.
And when the project is completed, please send me the link for that. I could go straight to the movie, please. It will be helpful.
Okay.
So when students are done writing the paper for the movie, send me the link in the body of the email, please. Are there any questions pertaining to assignments and course announcements?
Reference the take-home exam, Dr. Mark.
Yes.
Based on previous courses that I've completed, I know it's time-bound. So are you saying that you will post it, but once we open it, we have a certain time to complete it?
I didn't hear you.
You hearing me now? Yes.
Yes, yes.
I was saying, based on previous experience, I know the exam is usually time-bound, meaning you have 24 hours or how much ever to complete it. So are you saying you will post it and we can open it at any time, but we must complete it within a certain time?
Well, okay, this is where people seem to be having challenges. Normally the aim is that in my experience, I have given people a time sensitive period to complete the exam. Some people have turned their assignment and they have lost points. What I thought was that you'd give people a certain amount of time to complete the exam and it's turning. As I said before, if you choose to, we can go back again and we can make a vote. Do you want the exam a specific time to turn the exam? Because after this, I don't want people to ask me about any extensions. I'm not going to facilitate that.
So are you saying currently there's no time attached, no time frame attached?
What I did say was the exam to be turned the 31st of December. However, okay. I said people can turn in the exam before that.
Can start at any time and turn it in.
I would prefer that. The maximum time for you to turn it in. I give people time, but you can start it. It's preferable you start it right now.
Okay.
But I have not yet posted the exam yet. As I told Mr. Nyame, I'll post it around the 8th of December. I will not give, that's not the time for that right now, because we have not even completed the half of the course yet, so that wouldn't be appropriate.
Okay. Understood.
So I will post it. I'll send the exam link to him the week of the 8th of December.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Any other question before we move on to the lecture?
Michelle was asking how would you choose the list, or you choose the movies, but I told her that there's a list on Moodle now with the movies to choose from.
Students, you need to go onto the, there is a special provision made. There were two materials posted. One was just an explanation of movies in psychology and movies for you to read for your reading. And also there is a list of movies that do have DSM themes or disorders. You choose one and follow the instructions that were given in the syllabus. All right? But as I said, it would be helpful for you to start from now. Do not wait until the last moment. You don't have, all you have right now is the presentations. You don't really have anything else but start. If you need to turn in early, I will be happy because I need to get this course wrapped up soon. But I give people leeway to finish, and people have agreed to do it for the 31st of December. But it's on, it has been uploaded, the movie, the titles have been already been uploaded. And as I remind you, when you have made a choice, send me the title, and you at the ending, when you're finished with the paper, send me also the link to the movie that I can also look at it and watch it also. All right, so I think we need to move off of the announcements for now. I think it's clear. And so we're going to be looking or focusing on the topics that are in the syllabus. Again, just to remind people that the postings, the first post tonight is due at 11:55 on labeling theory. The that note you're supposed to have online to make notes and respond to that. And the second post is due Wednesday at 11:55. All right, so having said that, let us now, according to the syllabus, we have models of psychopathology. We're going to look at that briefly. I know we had in the first chat, you had sent you some information on models of psychopathology. But it's important for us to elaborate on what this is, because it is going to give you an understanding or give you some indication of what abnormality is. Just to recap last week for the lecture, basically the gist of my lecture was that deviance is more societal driven, where people break standards, norms in terms of standards of behavior. Abnormality is more individual driven, intrapsychic tensions where people are dealing with disorders that impact them from societal pressures. And so basically what we've been looking at this evening is looking at some models of psychopathology. In other words, what are the causation of abnormality? Last week we looked at the process of abnormality. We look at the process. Now we're going to look at the problems that abnormality causes individuals and, in fact, society. So therefore, I know I'd sent you some, I put online some handouts on models of abnormality. And tonight I'm going to just go through, go through quickly what I call three pivotal periods leading up to what is abnormal behavior, in studying it, in understanding abnormal behavior. Three pivotal periods. One is what I call the historical foundations of abnormal behavior. One is the historical foundations of abnormal behavior. Two, we're going to look at the pre-modern times of abnormality. Pre-modern times of abnormality. And three, we are going to look at the modern contemporary approaches. One, historical foundations. Two, pre-modern times of abnormality. And the third, contemporary approaches to abnormality. Contemporary approaches to abnormality. Now let's quickly look at what we call the historical foundations. Now, I'm not certain if you recall, I had sent you a Did you get, you can unmute your mics to answer. Did I send you or did I put online a PowerPoint on psychopathology? Did you get it? And unmute your mics to answer, please.
I don't recall seeing it, Dr. Mark.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't recall seeing it either.
Okay, my apologies. Okay, all right. Well, what I'll do, I will discuss it, what I'm sending. I'll probably have it sent to Mr. Nami, and then I'll elaborate on the topic at hand, and then you can follow afterwards. Now, in looking at the historical foundations, we are talking about a period where illnesses were seen by the supernatural. So the supernatural played a role in abnormality. One of the main tenets, I believe, of abnormality in that period was the matter of explaining, using the supernatural forces to explain the phenomenon of mental illness at that time. Using the supernatural to explain the phenomena of mental illness. So the matter of possessions by unnatural forces were prevalent. And so the thinking at that time was that there are unseen forces that contributed to human behavior. So people at that time, one of the main areas of understanding was a process called triphoning. Triphoning, I'll spell it, T-R-I-P-H-O-N-I-N-G. Triphoning. And this means that the philosophy of that time was that there are forces that sought to control behavior externally, and so the matter of nature and religious experience was important. And so to control people who were controlled by these forces, people found a way to leave suffering by boring a hole in someone's skull and letting spirits out. So that's one of the main pivotal areas of that era. Triphoning was one of the techniques. The second one I want to talk about within that same area is what is known as somatogenic. In other words, that the people in the early, from the early Greeks to early Middle Ages, believed that the body, that illness came about from the body. I mean, and so the illness came from a diseased body. So the matter of somatogenesis is an early form of a model in terms of explaining behaviors. So that the general theme or the general trend was that the body was diseased, and because the body was diseased, it was a process where, for example, the brain played a very pivotal role in explaining behaviors, like study of syphilis, for example, that the process of the brain causes this kind of illnesses. So in looking then, continuing in looking at that period also. In looking at that period, this period will have led to a direct connection to the pre-modern era, the rise of asylums, the rise of humane treatment for the mentally ill. So before, in the early historical times, the mentally ill were not treated very well. They were subjected to abuse and superstition, and this is when you have the persecutions of witches in that those times, because of people's the pervasiveness of or the perception of what abnormality should be. So in looking then at the emerging pre-modern era, the matter of the psychogenic period, emerged. This is a period of the Freuds, Pinel, the Freudians, the Neo-Freudians, Pinel came about. That the process, the thought was that mental illness came not just from the body, but it came originate from the mind, that the process of mental illness came from the mind. This was a period of the Victorian age, where political correctness and people were in a period where there was much more focus on decorum, and people were be able to deal with their repression of their own feelings. And there was a time when this is when Freud's development of psychoanalytical theory came about. So the matter of people like Charcot in this period was important. As I said, Freud, Charcot, Pinel, these are forces that came about and looked at how mental illness manifested itself within the mind. So the matter of the combination then of somatogenic symptoms and psychogenic symptoms came about what is known as psychosomatic symptoms. Have you ever heard of that word before? Mute your mics. Unmute your mics. Psychogenic symptoms or psychosomatic symptoms. Have you heard of that term before?
It sounds familiar, Dr. Mark.
What do you think it means?
Well, from my little bit of reading, I think somatic has something to do with physical.
Somatic, yes.
Yeah, with physical symptoms, characteristics, things like that, like headaches and asthma, like that.
Sorry?
Like headaches and asthma?
Yes. Well, yes. So it's psychosomatic means that there is a physical, there are emotional origins, but it manifests itself primarily physically. That's what psychosomatic means. But we're looking at the connections of the period that we talked about. That psychogenic means that these are it's more like a conversion hysteria or like a conversion reaction where there were emotional manifestations that came about as in physical symptoms, such as hysterical blindness, glove anesthesia, and I'll explain what that means. In other words, glove anesthesia is the feelings of something occurring in the limbs, but there was or that the one's limbs were there was tingling sensation in the limbs, or that the feeling that there was no, the limbs were cut off. That's glove anesthesia. So in other words, when there's intense intrapsychic tension, it is such that the person tends to disassociate, and so there is a manifestation of in physical terms. Is it clear? Is it clear?
Yes, Dr. Ma.
Okay. Need to get feedback because I don't know. I need to know if I'm talking nonsense or rubbish.
I had a question concerning
the process of
trifling.
Yes, go ahead.
You mentioned that external forces control behavior. I was wondering if that is so, why did they pierce a hole in the skull to let the demons out?
Well, the interaction between the forces, the natural forces, that these forces, in other words, in a supernatural time, but people were part of a process where spirits control behavior. So the aim was that the spirits sometimes would have entered the person through other means. And so for them, the matter of, it's an early form, it's an early technique. In other words, it trifling, if you look at it though, it has origins, because if you look at a person who has hydrocephalus, for example, in modern times, the matter of putting a shunt in one's brain to drain out cerebrospinal fluid out of the brain has its origin in trifling. So it does have it, in words, but the aim that time was to drive out evil spirits.
So it was assumed that the external forces would have entered the person.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
There was really a belief system that says that spirits control the processes of life, and so when the imbalance would have meant when spirits enter the person, that this caused an imbalance. So it had its origin in early Greek, in the Greek, where they had phlegm and bile and in the terms of how people are labeled, but later as a society progress, that's one way of relieving pressure from, or relieving for people to treat mental illness. It is to bore a hole in the skull of a person to let the spirits out. So that's the early period. So we look at the history. We have read that before. That just you had, but I'm just making a summary of some of the models of causation of mental illness. Any other questions?
Question, doctor.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. I have a question.
Yes.
Ignorance, or was it on the basis of ignorance, or was it just that was their lived reality? But the treatment was
both. Beg your pardon?
Okay. I'm not sure if you're hearing me correctly.
No, you're breaking up.
I was asking the question if it was on the basis of ignorance why they chose to treat mental illnesses, or was it just, was it their lived reality, but the treatment was not appropriate for...
I think it was the basis of both, that at that point in time, that people could not understand abnormal behavior before, and so people at that period, if you read the history of mental illness, you'll find that the way to manage people who got very reserved because there were no drugs to control people. So a person who would probably, what you call psychotic, would be chained. Or they would be subjected to chaining, or they'd be beaten or burnt at the stake. And so because of not only the primitivism of thinking, but the prevailing religious, in other words, religion had a lot to do with the matter of the supernatural, to explain away what abnormality is in that area. And so people had this view of demonology and to account primarily for how people got mentally ill. Is it clear now, Mr. Hello?
Yes, Dr. Mark, thank you.
All right.
Yes, so clear, thank you.
Okay, so we don't want to belabor the point because our time is going, but the modern era is where we find actually before I go into the modern era, let me comment about the matter of the beginning of the biological model. The pre-modern era, people like Pinel and all those, and Freud, and the beginning of the biological model. In other words, the combination of biology and genetics to explain mental disturbances. So in other words, the matter of disease that psychopathology is considered a disease. A disease that it is caused by brain defects or abnormalities in the brain. Brain defects or abnormalities in the brain. And this involves neurotransmitters in the brain caused by transmitters. There's also the matter of genetic predisposition, that genes played a role. This is pre-modern times, that genes, not necessarily evil spirits or spirits, but genetics played a role. The genes had a role in the development of psychopathology. So there is a matter of inheritance from parents that this is due to what is known as familial transmission. Familial transmission familial transmission familial transmission that is it is due to It is due primarily to blood relatives who will transmit a genetic defect. So there are some disorders. There will be some disorders like schizophrenia, for example, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia. Bipolar disorder. alcoholism, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, alcoholism, learning disability, that can be attributed to genetic disposition. In this period, in the 1960s, there were several studies, research, like the twin studies. Is someone asking a question? In the twin studies, it is determined that based upon what is called heritability, heritability, that the more genetic material you have, like identical twins versus monozygotic twins, or you have a parent who may have the disorder, like schizophrenia, the more likely you are to have it. So the more closer the genetic material, the more risk you have. So if both parents, for example, have schizophrenia, or if both parents have a history of depression, you are prone to that. The second period within that period I want to talk about is the rise of medications, or development of medications to treat mental illness. So in the 1960s, the development of antipsychotic medications came about. The 1960s, Thorazine, Thorazine, was one of the first antipsychotic medications to treat psychosis. So you have what is called, these are called neuroleptic drugs, N-E-U-R-O, leptic drugs. These are drugs that treat psychosis. In other words, they target dopamine. They target the neurotransmitter, dopamine, in the brain. Dopamine. Unmute your mics. Any questions?
None from me, Dr. Mark. It's clear as crystal.
Anybody clear as mud? Anybody?
Yes,
anybody? Somebody says, please spell it again. Spell what, Miss Mighty Helogene? Spell what? What should I spell? Mr. Naomi, could you get information from her, please? Not certain what I need to spell. Oh, Thorazine. T-H-O-R-A. Thorazine. Z-I-N-E. It's an antipsychotic drug. You're welcome. Okay, so the rounds of so the development of, as I said, antipsychotic drugs was extremely important in making the breakthrough from the what I call the historical times. And so the drugs, people now begin to look at that it's not necessarily the supernatural, but that the brain had a role to play, and genetics and genes in development of mental illness. So what also happened at that time was also the development of antidepressants. Antidepressants also was developed. Very important to understanding, because the biological model is part of that tradition, the pre-modern tradition. Any question? Unmute your mics. Any questions? Any questions?
None from me, Dr. Mark.
I should also mention, ladies and gentlemen, that I won't be elaborate here, but there was also the beginning of a classical system of disorder. In other words, a categorization of disorders, which we'll talk about when we in lecture 3 of the DSM. A categorization, a classical system of mental illness. And let me just summarize. Now, what is this classified? We look at classification in terms of, I mean, I think you have read on the labeling theory. Have you been reading, listening or reading that? Unmute your mics.
Yes, Dr. Ma.
What have you, since you're, unmute your mics for question and answers. What have you learned about labeling? Anybody?
In terms of deviance, that no behavior is inherent. Pardon?
Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yes. In terms of deviance, that no inherently. No behavior is deviant, but it depends on how society reacts to it. So that, for example, if there is no reaction from society, then the behavior would not be classified as deviant.
Yes.
But if there is a reaction, and a significant
yes.
reaction from society, then the behavior mm-hmm. becomes classified as deviant.
Okay.
So it's believed that deviance is socially constructed.
I didn't hear you.
So it's believed that deviance, on a labeling theory, posits that deviance is socially constructed because it's dependent on the response of society.
Okay. So for your thesis is that labeling theory is a sociological process.
Yes.
Explain.
Because if society does not respond
yes.
Negatively, then it's not classified as deviance.
If it's something
that they just browse over, then it's not classified as deviance. But if they make a big deal about it, well, then it's definitely classified as deviance.
Okay, now other persons, what's your view on labeling theory? We're going a bit into classification of disorders or categorization of disorders of abnormality. What's your view of the label? What do you understand about labeling theory? Anybody?
To add to what was said.
I am. Go ahead.
Kojo, are you hearing me?
Yes, I'm hearing you.
You're hearing me.
I am hearing you. Go ahead.
Oh, to add to what was said earlier, that yes, it is socially constructed, but so the society's view or the society accepts what is deviant. So is a person has something bad, and it may be, the person may be seen as a hero or probably as in a negative light because they accept as leader.
Mm-hmm. Now, in the light of labeling theory as a sociological paradigm, would you also say that that abnormality is a label? And if it is, what type of label is it? In what process, in what context is it a label?
Well, it's
seen as go ahead.
Yes?
So I thought Kudo was answering. Okay, so in terms of the labels that society ascribes, for example, drug addict or mm-hmm. somebody who is psycho, if the person's behavior can be classified within, for example, the DSM,
yes.
then I would say yes, it's abnormality.
Mm-hmm.
So in that context, I would say if they meet the criteria for substance abuse disorder,
yes.
or for antisocial personality disorder, which is usually classified as psycho, I would say yes, abnormality exists.
Okay, let me ask you, the students. I've not heard from those who are online. I've not heard from Marshall Lee. I've not heard from the others. Or the others who are watching on YouTube, what say you? Questions, please. I see a question here. Secondary deviance is, I'm going to read what she said. Mm-hmm. Okay. Hello, Jean says that it is when a person repeatedly violates norms, which leads others to make assumptions about the person and assign a label. When a person is being labeled, they tend to believe that label and begin to act accordingly because they are shunned from other social groups to what is labeling. Do you agree or disagree, ladies and gentlemen?
I agree to some extent that the person labeled based on what I've read so far about labeling theory, they tend to incorporate the label, and that guides their behavior, and sometimes that behavior can become abnormal.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Because they incorporate the label that is assigned by society.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
and
so
I believe the theory says that leads to stigma, which is, I guess, the next stage.
Okay, so in other words, we're looking at labeling as a sociological process.
Yes.
And we're looking at labeling as stigma. Correct?
Yes.
I also see a question that abnormality is seen as a label from a sociological context. Victor, could you explain that, please, Victor? Could someone explain? Could he explain what he means?
What did he say, Dr. Ma?
Abnormality is seen as a label from a sociocultural context. Victor, could he or someone explain that? And I will chime in.
Sociocultural.
I suppose what he's trying to say, Dr. Mark, is that what may be labeled abnormal in a particular culture or context may not necessarily be considered abnormal in another context.
Yes.
So that is really sociocultural context from this.
Yes. But is it labeling, nevertheless, across cultures?
Well, labeling is assigning a particular category or classification or perhaps an identification of a, I don't use back the word label again, but assigning a particular disorder or, I'm going to say, category of abnormality. That is my explanation of labeling.
Well, we have been talking from the pre-modern era about, we talked about classifications, so we are going into that a little bit, and we are still in the pre-modern times, because it's important, because these theories like the biological and the genetic developed as a result of ascribing us a description of us to understand as a set of defined behaviors that are unpredictable. That's a phenomenon. So labeling, ladies and gentlemen, in my view, is assigning it's a formal, systematic, take notes, it's formal and systematic, and it is assigning or providing an explanation. It's providing an explanation to a phenomena of behaviors that need to be categorized to understand it. So it's assigning a phenomena of behaviors that needs understanding within the context of abnormality. Now, what do I mean by that?
Dr. Mark, could you repeat?
Okay. In other words, labeling has a sociological origin, I agree, but it's more than that. It is within the context of abnormality. We are looking at a phenomena that is embodied in a series of behaviors, can be in either clusters, categories, or traits. Let me repeat. It's assigning a phenomena to a series of behaviors. It's assigning a phenomenon or a series of behaviors, assigning a phenomena or labeling phenomena to behaviors that have traits, categories, and characteristics. So in that period, then, the matter of diagnosis was prevalent. In the pre-modern era, diagnosis or diagnostic categories became prevalent. And so these classifications, so labeling them is a classification or is of groups of behavioral phenomena. And so in terms of the idiopathic approach, I said it last week, IDEOPATH, PATHIC. Individuals are assigned to various categories of groups to explain behavior. That is called the idiopathic approach. Now, let's continue. What I didn't say last week, and I'm saying it this week, is another process in that era called the nomothetic approach. Nomothetic, N-O-M-O-T-H-E-T-I-C, nomothetic approach. Now, the nomothetic approach is looking at categories of mental of disorders. As general groups or categories of behavior. That's so you're looking, you're studying mental illness in terms of what is known as taxonomy. You're studying mental illness in terms of what is known as taxonomy. So the nomothetic approach is looking at groups or clusters of behaviors from a societal standpoint. Nomothetic groups of behaviors and how they impact society is called the nomothetic approach. Any questions so far before I continue on this? Unmute your mics. Any questions? Any questions?
Not so much.
Yes.
So you're saying that labeling, even though it has a sociological origin, it
yes, is
primarily looking at mental illnesses in terms of group.
Yes. In other words, mental illness in terms of the nomothetic approach is looking at how mental disorders are categorized in terms of groups. For example, what do I mean by that? If you go to the DSM-5, you will see distinct categories. The psychosis, the depressive disorders, the traumas, the somatoform disorders. So there are certain what I call a taxonomic groups of clusters of behaviors that every behavior falls on it. And it may not be that each person may have the same symptom, but overall, as long as it as that group, if you can fit that behavior within that group process, it's called the nomothetic approach. It's called taxonomy. Is it clear?
Yes, Dr. Ma.
So when you look at the DSM, look for categories, classifications. They're all under one. This is why I said to you, when you're in your prison, you can't do all of them because the dissociative disorders have several disorders and not each disorder have certain symptoms, but they're not the same in each individual. You see what I mean?
Yes, Dr. Hello? Question, Dr. Ma.
Yes.
In the absence of classification, we're saying that a label has an aspect of social construct, but it also has an aspect of classification. In the absence of the classification, how would we regard a label?
In the absence of what?
Of the classification aspect of it.
How would we guard a label?
Yes. Would it be regarded as not being a label?
I was saying earlier we were
discussing based on our readings from labeling theory.
Yes.
That it involves a social construct. But now Yes. You've added that it also involves classification.
Mm-hmm.
So if society just ascribes a label, but it's not, for example, found in the DSM, can it be regarded as a label?
Be careful, because labeling, why do we have labels in psychopathology? If we're looking at labeling, and labeling is a misnomer, because in psychopathology it should be a matter of classifications, because labeling is a more generic term that society ascribes when people deviate from a certain norm. So a label is put on you in terms, if you look at it from a sociocultural standpoint, a person's deviant, it's really linked to what is known as behaviors that are seen as atypical in the society. But when we're looking at psychopathology, we are more looking at phenomena that of behaviors that are atypical from that individual. However, so in other words, it is more individuals, as I said before, the matter of classifications is that you are taking symptoms, a number of symptoms, and you're making a category of behaviors for that person to look. When you're looking at behavior, when you're looking at phenomena as a sign, or when you're looking at phenomena as what is reported from the patient, that is looking at looking at a label, and you're making, you know, you're not labeling what the person's behavior, you're labeling the manifestations of this intrapsychic tension from within the person. So what emits as symptoms are more more seen as individual specific. Society doesn't, a person within a society who deviates doesn't have those kind of symptoms. The person in a sociocultural context would more be violating a standard norms. And as I said before, it doesn't necessarily mean that they are deviant. That they are abnormal. It means that they are breaking the law based upon a standard of behavior. In abnormality, when it comes to a classification, you're looking at certain categories of behaviors to explain symptoms. So if a person comes to you with in a presenting complaint, Mr. James or Johnny is a six-year-old boy who is presenting with symptoms of hyperactivity, poor attention span, depression, and fighting. Those are asymptomatic of a person, not society. Do you understand? Is it clear?
Yes, Dr. Yes,
Dr. Is it clear? Is it clear?
Yes, Dr.
In other words, be careful, because we are taking those symptoms and we're looking in the DSM to determine what are the symptoms in these, what classification of disorders will explain this phenomenon of this person before me. They are reporting, normally should report this as symptoms. I am sad, I am feeling angry, I am feeling depressed, I have suicidal ideation. You're seeing person is fighting, child is fighting, child can't concentrate, the child can't sit still. Oh, I'm assigning, these are the symptoms, assigns to me, these are symptoms of certain behaviors of the category of attention deficit disorders. So you see the categories. In other words, you're taking those symptoms and you're ascribing them within a cluster of categories to explain that phenomenon when the child comes to you, because every patient has different phenomena of their behavior. Is it clear?
Yes, Dr. Mack.
Anybody else? I'm not hearing from the other students. I want to make sure this is clear. Anybody else? Is this clear?
Yes, Dr. Mack.
Is this clear, everybody? I've not heard from Ms. Williams. I've not heard from the other students. Is this very clear?
Yes, Dr. Mack.
All right, so let's look then with still within the matter of the pre-moderns. Very important. It's a very huge, and I'm wondering if I should continue. Mr. Nyame? Is Mr. Nyame there?
Yes, I'm here.
It would appear that we may have to break this down into two, because this is a very, very extremely big topic.
Okay.
So I don't know if we can have a second chat within. I don't know how that's going to work. Mm-hmm. But I think this is a very, very huge topic for them to understand before we even touch the DSM.
Okay.
I don't know if we can have another time when we can fit this into finish to conclude this lecture. But I'll continue. But I will not be really not even touching some other things I want to touch. Instead on models.
Okay.
So we can think about what other, we can think about something else after we have done conclude.
Okay, we'll think about it.
Yes, all right. But let's continue with the historical classification of mental disorders in that pre-modern times. Continuing. So the classification had roots, had origins 3,000 years ago in Egypt. Classification, in other words, it has origins 3,000 BC. So other cultures had sort of found a way to classify mental phenomena or behavioral phenomena. And this period of classification, that there was an attempt for systematic, comprehensive, and to organize the documentation of mental disorders. This was a period of intense debate about what constitutes psychopathology. This was a period of intense debate of what constituted psychopathology. For example, nature-nurture. Have you heard of a controversy? The nature-nurture? Nature-nurture. Mm-hmm. Nature-nurture. The matter of the labeling theory had disputes and they had tensions in terms of labeling, the labeling theory in that period. In other words, tensions, the labeling period was the fact that tensions existed, and and there were disagreements about whether to, how to put people into categories. How to put people into categories of disorders or groups. How or whether to put people into categories or groups. Continuing on the same category classification, in the same period, I haven't gone yet off of it, that there were three main periods of categorization. I'm going to send this to you. I think what I'm going to do is that I'm going to send it to Mr. Nyami for you to for my notes. I'm going to send it to you, but just I'm just going to summarize for your for the notes for you to understand. Three main periods of in terms of the classification. One, very important, is based in the 18th century. This came about in the 18th century, the work of Linnaeus. Linnaeus. L-I-N-N-A-E-U-S. Linnaeus. He was the first to categorize humans and animal species. He was the first to categorize humans and animal species. Linnaeus, very important in the history of psychopathology. Two, still under the 18th century, William Cullen adopted the principles of Linnaeus for classifying types of mental disorders. Types of mental disorders, and then he was also involved in publishing in 1769 his works on understanding the classification of mental disorders, including neuroses and psychoses. So he published a set, or his works involve a set of classification of mental disorders, including neuroses, that is, disorders that are based upon persons, it's more of a mild form of mental illness versus psychosis, more that is more severe form of detachment from reality. This period also had leaned heavily on philosophy. This period also leaned heavily on philosophy in terms of two sets of research paradigms. Philosophy in terms of two sets of research paradigms. One, people who were researchers who were called splitters. splitters, S-P-L-I-T-T-E-R-S. That is, they divide mental categories into narrowly defined categories. Define mental disorders into narrowly defined categories. Two, or I should say B under that, the lumpers. Lumpers. These are broadly defined categories. Broadly defined categories that are adequate to represent abnormality. Any questions so far? Any questions? Unmute your mics. Any questions? Any questions? Is it clear, students? Clear?
Yes, Dr. Matt,
yes, clear for me. Doctor.
Okay, good. Now, I know this is heavy stuff, but that's why we I'm thinking we have to break this up, because this is heavy, and you need to understand it is a basis to understand the DSM-5. Doesn't make sense going to DSM-5 without understanding the history of classification and where the DSM is coming from. I'm seeing an email here that they are listening, not in the chat, but they're understanding. Good. All right, let's continue. Now, another historical figure in the same pre-modern period is called Emil Kraepelin. Emil Kraepelin. And I spell it K-R-A-E-P-E-L-I-N, Kraepelin. Very important figure in the DSM tradition. He looked at psychopathology in terms of the scientific approach. He primarily believed that psychopathology had roots in biology and in the biological tradition, in other words, in biology and neurology, in other words, the study of of the nervous system. So he primarily looked at disorders from a scientific view. He was heavily influenced by Wilhelm Wundt. Wilhelm Wundt, W-U-N-D-T. This Kraepelin was also very famous for his textbook of psychiatry. He was a psychiatrist. Very famous for his textbook of psychiatry. And he was part of the splitters that look at the groupings of mental disorders. So if you look at the DSM-5, you'll see Kraepelin mentioned in understanding the history. His work basically is based upon two types of psychiatric classification, because as I said, he was a psychiatrist. His work is based upon two types, and that's how the history of psychopathology came about. Two types of psychiatric classification, or two major types rather, at that period. One is the history of dementia praecox. Dementia praecox. D-E-M-E-N-T-I-A, praecox, P-R-A-C-O-X. modernly known as schizophrenia. It was that name was a name for schizophrenia, dementia praecox. And he was responsible for the subcategories of schizophrenia. The second major type of classification in his system is the manic depression. Manic depression. And his work gave rise to melancholia. For example, depressive disorder with melancholic features, but melancholia and mania. Bipolar disorder, manic type, mania. So that's the work of Kraepelin. Any questions? Are there any questions? Are there any questions?
None for me, Dr. Ma.
Anybody else? Any questions on the pre-modern era?
No questions for me.
Okay, no questions. Let's continue and wrap up. The Neo-Kraepelians. Neo-Kraepelians. Are we ready? Are we ready?
Yes, Dr. Ma.
Okay. These were a group of North American researchers. Who borrowed heavily from Kraepelin, but said that diagnosis they borrowed from Kraepelin's view of psychopath classification and psychopathology, but they said that diagnosis and classification are important in as a branch of medicine. The Neo-Kraepelians said, "Yes, we agree with Kraepelin, but we also agree that diagnosis and classification are important branch of medicine." So they are basically, they were responsible for the medical model of mental illness. I see someone shaking their heads. Does it seem like it's ringing? It's the medical model of mental illness. The one form of that is the biological tradition that says that drugs alone will treat mental illness. And that's where that's coming from. So the medical model says that mental illness is primarily a disease of the brain. So it's the matter of disease was important. So when you're looking at the matter of psychiatry, because the DSM-IV is basically written by psychiatrists. Well, the American Psychiatric Association was the one who. So they had an approach that mental illness is based upon the medical model. That mental illness is primarily a disease. Any questions? Any questions so far?
Hold off to Mark, maybe later.
Any questions?
No, Dr. Mack, not for me.
All right. So we have touched on the pre-modern model. I'm going to now touch a little bit on for another half an hour or so on the modern period. Now we have spent, if you notice, we have spent a lot of time on the models alone. We have not touched, we have touched a little bit on labeling, and we haven't touched on the object relations yet. But let's look at the modern period. Now the modern period, basically looked at was a reaction from the medical model. Deviation from the medical model. In other words, there were a set of assumptions about mental illness to explain behavior. So the modern era was known as the third force psychology. Third force psychology. That is the role of behavior in social contexts. How human beings function in society came about. And there are a number of approaches within this area, and I'm not certain I'm going to be able to finish this evening, but I'll do what I can. But one of the things that I wanted to talk about is the role of Freud in this matter of the modern era. Even though he belonged somewhat in the pre-modern era, I think that his works are so major that to explain behavior, that he was one of the leading proponents of the role of the past, the role of childhood factors to explain human behavior. Yes, I see Miss. I can see Miss Marshall looking like she's puzzled.
Trying to figure out the role of what? What kind of factors did you say, Dr. Marshall?
No, I'm saying the role of what I said was that Freud looked at the role of early internal conflict to explain behavior. So for him, the role of early parent-child behavior, relationships were important.
You're saying, Dr. Matt, that he was one of the leading proponents of
something or another.
Explaining the intra-psychic tensions of person's relation to mental illness. He saw development in terms of the psychosexual stages. He looked at development in terms of psychosexual stages. For him, successfully navigates a person who will be considered adjusted if they are able to pass through the stages. If they were not able to pass through the stages, they will be known as fixated in that stage or stuck in that stage. Someone says, please repeat. Miss Mighty, what should I repeat? Someone says, please repeat. Elogene, what should I repeat?
That was before, earlier.
Oh. All right. Yes. So the psychosexual stages in Freud's philosophy was very, very important. Freud looked at the role of the unconscious in mental illness. The role of the unconscious in mental illness. And this is related to, and this role of the unconscious is rooted in the early parent-child relationships. If there was no resolution between the parent and child, intrapsychic tension would have developed within the individual. Intrapsychic tension would have developed in the individual. And this would lead to early development of mental disturbance. I'm hearing
Latay, you're here. Can you mute your mic? Let me mute it for you, Latay. She finally got on that tone.
Okay, great. Wonderful.
Okay.
Not finished with you yet, just now you basically just reflecting about I'm going to my notes, you probably won't see me. Freud had a model of the mind, and for him it is, as you know, the id, which is raw energy that powers the mind. I believe that this was sent to you. You have this information, Mr. Nabi.
We're seeing you, Dr. Mark. So
you're still seeing me?
Yeah, because you may be seeing something else on your screen, but we are seeing you, so
okay,
you know.
Because I'm trying to go through notes and speak at the same time. But the aid, which is that is raw energy that powers the mind, this is gratification of basic urges. The id's processes are unconscious, so for him, conflict starts in the id, or mental illness, or mental disturbances start in the id. For him, the ego is the part of the mind that deals with reality. The ego, conscious part of the mind that deals with reality. And lastly for him, the superego is related to the conscience. Which is in fact true, because if the part of the brain called the prefrontal cortex is linked to consciences in and right or wrong in humans. So it's the final part of the brain. I mean, it's a part of the mind rather that deals with the conscience. All right. Are there any questions?
Well, yes, for me, Dr. Matt, I know it's very interesting to learn all
yes.
of these models.
Well, we're going to have to continue with these models because I am not finished. It's a lot. So I'm going to have to indulge Mr. Niyama to see if we can have another chat in between to see if we can finish this up. Because I'm not finished. It will be not doing justice to you to not continue. But go ahead.
I'm just wondering how they're coming though, Dr. Mark. Is it that in our writing you expect us to refer to the various models?
What writings?
In whatever assignments you give to us. Or this is just for background information?
No, this is not, you're talking about, this is just for background. Well, this is, background and also to give you a... It's almost like a prelude to the DSM-5, for you to understand the background of the diagnostic manual. So, no, if you are to do any writing, would be the posting. It will be you what the material you have online, which has to do with the labeling theory. Now, let me ask a question. Unmute your mics. It's now 10 o'clock by my watch. Have students started to post yet?
No, Dr. Mark.
So it's now 10 o'clock, so it looks like we may have to do a conclusion to give people time to. Mr. Niyama, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
What do you think? Should we give them again another time to post, or tomorrow? The light of what's happening?
Well, according to Elder Jean's head shaking, she's suggesting yes.
She's shaking.
Okay.
All right. Okay. I'm going to give you until tomorrow to post the first post and Wednesday the second post. How is that, everybody? Unmute your mics.
Thank you, Dr. Mark. Appreciate it.
You're welcome. She's smiling. I see someone smiling. They're happy. They're relieved. All right. I think I'm getting a little tired myself. So what I'm going to do is that this is a very important topic. So we can't do this all tonight. It's pretty comprehensive. Mr. Niyama, what do you recommend? Do you recommend that we have another chat this week to finish this up, and then we don't have to bring it over next week?
Well, the challenge with that is that maybe anybody in here is Adventist? Do we know if anybody on your team is Adventist? Hello? Nobody in here is Adventist.
So we can do it on Saturday?
Yes. That's fine with me. We'll try for Saturday.
Yes. I think this is the best because it's a lot and I'm getting a little tired myself. But so we'll try first to wrap up this.
We'll decide on the time.
You decide on the time, Mr. Naomi. We have to go by your time.
Okay. I'm a morning person, you know. Oh, it's 5 a.m. for everybody.
No.
Okay.
No.
You said decide the time. about 11.
11? Okay, that's 12 o'clock. Okay, that's fine. I should be bright and early.
Okay. But we will decide fully on that as we go. I'll send out the email.
Yes. So You're saying Saturday we'll wrap this up because I have some more we haven't touched yet, and so I will continue with the third wave, which is the third traditions, which is a modern period, and to continue with what I have to say. Are there any questions, ladies and gentlemen?
Dr. Mark, I'm not available on Saturday, so I have to listen to the recording.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. I have a previous engagement.
Somebody is saying that the afternoon is better.
Yes, Michelle was saying that.
Well, we have to have a consensus.
I'll work with the time, you know. If it's afternoon, afternoon will be better for you.
Pardon? Yes.
Let's work on the afternoon.
So afternoon,
evening would be better for me. All day, so I'm not available during the day.
Okay.
So evening is better for me. If not, I'll just listen to the tape.
All right, we need everybody here. We need everybody here if we have to make this decision.
Well, we'll send an email, Dr. Mark. We'll send an email. I can even go vote on I could set up something on Moodle for them to decide, you know.
Well, do that. Let me know. Somebody's saying, she's saying 12 p.m. I don't know.
12 p.m. 12 a.m., which is it?
No.
Yeah, we will decide. Right,
so afternoon seems to be the better time for people.
Yeah.
Unmute your mic.
Evening. What about you, Dr. Mark? Evening is all right with you?
Yes.
I can work with the evening.
People, students, evening?
Evening is fine with me, Dr. Mark.
Unmute your mics, please. Evening.
Evening is good for me as well.
People listening by YouTube.
Yeah, Michelle, I said evening already. She said.
All right, we will decide on the evening. Now, the problem is, what's evening? So we'll decide, Mr. Naomi, you decide the evening since you're the one who is doing the technology part of it, this lecture. Could you tell us what time, please?
Okay. Would 6 p.m. be okay?
That's 7 my time.
I'll work. Let's try for 6 p.m., okay?
6 p.m. That's 7 my time. All right, we'll do 6. Ladies and gentlemen, did you hear? 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Okay.
Is everybody on the same page?
Yes, Dr. Mark, that's 7 p.m. for me as well.
Okay. Is everybody on the same page? Ladies and gentlemen, we need to know this today.
Yes, Dr.
Other people. Other people need to chime in by email.
Yes, it's okay.
People want to know group one about the group work. You can send it to me. I'll send her an email. Can I send an email, Mr. Niame, to tell her that I need that she can send it to me during the day? I'll try to look at it.
She's here in England.
Okay, you can send it to me during the day. I will try and look at it. Just to remind students that the group one will be presenting on Monday. So it means that we need to be really on time for this. We don't want, because right now tonight we started about almost 45 minutes late. That's why we are ending. We have to have another chat. You can go ahead and send it, Michelle. You can send it to me during the day, the presentation. All right. Are there any other questions? Just to remind people that tomorrow, absolute deadline is for that post. It's tomorrow, Tuesday. Okay? If you have started and you send it to that, that's fine, but you have until tomorrow night to send it. Any question before we part?
No, not at this time.
Okay. Well, I think we need to end on a note of prayer. So Vanessa?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Could you close in prayer for us, please?
Certainly. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the session this evening. Lord, I cover Dr. Mark. I cover each student with the blood of Jesus. I cover our families, oh God. I pray for your wisdom, your guidance, oh God, as we go through this yet another process of learning. I pray that you will guide us, you will direct us, you will open our minds and our understanding to understand the concepts that we are interacting with. Be with us, oh God, as we work on our different assignments. I thank you for guiding us. Thank you for strengthening Dr. Mack and for helping her as she guides us through this process as well. Go with us now as we depart from each other, God, and as we continue to work on our assignments. In Jesus' precious name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.